Previously, we made this 3D printed RC dump truck, and while it's great for disposing of 3D printer poops, I'm afraid it's not suited for the great outdoors, nor keeping up with the capabilities of the RC excavator. Which is why today, we'll be striving to make it bigger, stronger, and dare I say, unstoppable. Now for reference, the RC skid steer and RC excavator sit around the 1/18th to 1/20th scale mark. The original dump truck is around the 1/80th scale mark, meaning it's relatively tiny compared to the others. This specific model was loosely based off a mine haul truck, and for a direct size comparison, I'm gonna use the Caterpillar 797, which is 14.8 meters long. So even this revised version will not be scaled anywhere near 1/20th, as in length that would reach 72 centimeters and definitely be a little overkill. Plus, I don't think many people would want to 3D print something that big, so instead I'm meeting in the middle at around the 1/50th scale, which when all put together will be about 26 centimeters long. That should give more than enough room to be useful when hauling debris around, as well as open up the internals to more powerful electronics, therefore making the truck more capable. Which is exactly where I'm going to start this project off. When I first made the mini dump truck, I was obsessed with the idea of running everything off one single cell lithium battery. I wanted to do this because it would take up less space, be lighter, and less expensive overall. This idea has a lot of hurdles to overcome though, and it all stems from the fact... And it all stems from the fact that this one battery outputs 3.7 volts, and realistically, we need at least 5 volts to use our servos. And to get any kind of usable power out of our 12 volt motors, we again need 5 volts. This is why some of you may have found that after only running the mini dump for a couple minutes, it would cut out or stall. That couple minutes of runtime is a drastic difference from the 30 plus minutes of runtime achievable on the excavator or skid steer. And this is because those both have not one, but two Phoenix batteries, which are wired in series giving 7.4 volts that is then dropped down to the 5 volts required for our servos. The N20 motors can use up to 12 volts, so those are just powered directly from the battery, or I should say the H bridges are powered directly from the battery, then those go to the motors. Which touches on another benefit of having two batteries, efficiency. Anytime you're boosting or bucking, which is dropping the voltage, some of that power is lost in the process. So preferably only run what is necessary through that converter. That said, when scaling this, my main priority is to make sure there's enough room in the chassis to fit two Phoenix batteries, which after scaling all the parts up by a factor of 1.5, there is plenty to do so. The new PCB design for this model that houses those two batteries is very similar to the skid steer, with the exception of a couple different pins. After having the file sent off to be manufactured, I received them about a week later, ready for the first test. Previously, where everything was crammed in the main chassis, there is now more than enough room, and I even splurged and made this nice cutout for the PCB to rest in, and can be further secured via one screw. When designing the PCB, I tried to keep everything critical easily accessible on top, which includes the batteries, terminal blocks, aux pins, and fuse holder. This model is relatively the largest to date, meaning that some of the bigger pieces take up a lot of 3D printer bed space. Something I took into consideration when scaling this was to make sure that the largest piece, being the dump bed, would still fit on an A1 mini, and supposedly if you angle it up at a 45 degree angle and then put a whole bunch of support underneath it, it'll fit. Though I haven't personally tested that as I don't own an A1 mini, but the slicer says it's possible. What I do know is that if your 3D printer bed is larger than 200 by 200, you'll have no problem fitting any of these parts on there. For example, my X1 Carbon is 235 by 235, and I can fit everything on there with ease. Now that we have parts printing, let's talk about the powertrain. On the OG mini dump, I used this single 300 RPM N20 motor powered at 5 volts. My first thought was just to keep it the same, except it would now be powered via 7.4 volts to make up the difference in size. But after further thought, I threw that idea out the window and moved onto a two motor design. My thought being that one, obviously more power baby, and two, previously the model really struggled to turn, and I believe that was in part due to the rear axle being locked, meaning one tire is not able to spin faster than the other to make up for the extra distance it's traveling, and instead either drags or skips along. So I split the axle in half, mushroomed the end so it'd stay in place, and slapped another motor in there. Another potential benefit to doing it this way is that in the code I could actually even send more power to that outside wheel to make for a faster turn in a way similar to tank steering. Speaking of code, there's now two options for controlling this build. The first is the standard using your phone or computer to control it, and I updated the code so that now when you give it the throttle, instead of letting go and it staying in the same place and your model driving off into infinity, it'll now bounce back to zero and actually stop, which was a big request on the original mini dump. I'm sorry for however many destroyed 3D prints I caused. Now, option number two is the ability to use it with a game controller. And I've recently been dabbling with a library called BluePad 32 versus the previous library I used, which was specific to PS3 controllers. Now, the advantage of BluePad 32 is that I can use a wide range of controllers. So I can still use the PS3 controller, but I can also use the 4 and 5, as well as any of the Xbox controllers 360 and up, and then even some random controllers like a Wii controller or an old Nintendo controller. There are just a lot of options. Though for the sake of this project, I only recommend trying the PlayStation controllers or Xbox controllers. The reason for my transition to this new library versus the PS3 specific library is that a couple people were having issues getting their controllers paired in general, or if they were on an Apple computer getting the tool installed to read the MAC address off of the controller. With this new library, if you're using a PS3 controller, you'll still have to manually get that MAC address info, but if you use a PS4/5 controller or perhaps a newer Xbox controller, it will automatically connect after holding the share button and then pressing the PS button, meaning that after downloading the code, no modification is required before uploading it to your ESP32 development board. The library BluePad 32 relies on a dependency called BT Stack, which is absolutely fantastic, so a special thanks to Blue Kitchen and Ricardo for the great resources. Links to their libraries in the description. After assembling everything and taking it out for its first test drive, it worked absolutely terrible. Well, maybe not terrible, but certainly not as well as I would have hoped. The split axle idea proved to be an epic fail for the same reason a rock crawler doesn't have open differentials, which is that if one wheel gets suspended, suddenly that's where all the power goes. Now, this isn't quite to the same extent as each motor powers a separate wheel, so it doesn't suddenly transfer all the way, but you definitely lose almost half your power. On perfectly flat ground, the turning radius did improve just slightly, but not enough to make up for the loss in off-road capabilities. So in order to see the difference and recoup my loss, I took some hot glue and glued the two axles together. I can now actually make it over a rug or up a small incline with success. Taking a break from the drive system, I want to work on tackling the dump bed dump motion. Instead of using a servo, I intend to put a threaded N20 motor to work, as the overall range of movement on this new model is obviously much larger, hence requiring much more power. Along with more power, a threaded N20 motor also has a tremendous amount of holding power, which, after threading a push rod with a nut installed onto the N20 motor, unless the motor is powered in one direction or the other, it's not going anywhere. Which is great for saving energy, as a servo in the same situation uses a lot of juice to hold its position. For maximum lift capacity, I would rate it at around 2 filament spools. The front of the dump truck received a small facelift with the addition of a high clearance front bumper for climbing over those pesky bumps, some D-rings purely for aesthetic purposes, and a solid front grille, which as you can see here, I had some fun with a multicolored print to make that brand pop. The reason for the solid grille is an attempt at making it more sand resistant, but more on that in a minute. I was so close to calling this model finished, but truth be told, it still struggles to turn, can hardly make it over anything with a load, and don't even get me started on trying to drive over rocks or grass. So with a last second change of heart, I ultimately decided that in order for this model to reach its full potential, it absolutely needs four-wheel drive. I had it in my head that this would be an extremely tough thing to make happen, but it was actually pretty simple. With the new scale of all the parts, instead of trying to run an axle out to the front wheels, which would require all kinds of pivot points and turning trouble, I simply inserted an N20 motor into the hub itself with the output directly linked to the wheel hub. I then routed the motor wires up through the wheel support to give it some play while turning, and just like that, the front tire was moving right along. The N20 motor is locked into the hub via these two clamps, which can be tightened down with two screws. Then the hub is locked to the motor shaft with a screw. This was the change that needed to happen. This little fella can now mop dirty over everything. Plus, now that the front end is pulling itself along, rather than being pushed, it turns on a dime. With a heavy load such as a couple filament rolls, it doesn't pause for a minute, or even struggle to climb up and over bumps slash obstacles. Better yet, it can now cruise around no problem in the rocks, grass, or sand. With all this newfound capability, you can believe that I was more than stoked to get the trailer updated as well, so I could haul all my much slower equipment around. After scaling the trailer by 1.5, it definitely wasn't gonna fit on a 3D printer, so I ended up chopping it in half, and then added the support required to make it sturdy. It came out really good, and reusing the same trailer hitch design here that utilizes the dump bed motor works just as well as it did before, if not even better now. When loaded with a skid steer, it of course works like a charm. When loaded with an excavator, still no problem. And when loaded up with both, still not a problem. The overall speed of the dump truck is so much faster than the excavator or skid steer that it truly makes sense to haul them if the destination is any further than 10 feet away. With the addition of the two new front motors, it's a little overkill to have two in the back as well, especially when the axle is locked together anyway. So I went ahead and redesigned the rear end one last time to just use a singular N20 motor, as well as re-geared it to be a 1-to-1 ratio to match the front. On top of that, I also changed the headlights to be dual LEDs. With all of these final updates completed, I loaded up my fancy fun filaments, which is really just this Hatchbox Gold, and took advantage of the Bamboo Labs AMS system. The main color will be gold, and then I applied black accents to the name, these stripes, as well as some other miscellaneous parts. Overall, I couldn't be happier with the redesign of this project, and I definitely feel like it's a valuable part of the fleet now. Now, unlike some of my previous projects, you may have noticed that a lot of these shots were filmed outside, which is something that I'm trying to slowly incorporate into these projects, which is making them more outdoor resistant. Previously, I had only ever intended to use these indoors, though recently my brother and I took some of the excavators out to a sandy beach, and I have to say, that was some of the most fun I've had with these models. We were crossing gaps, we were moving branches, we were building piles of dirt, we were using the plow attachment to plow things smooth to make a runway, the list goes on and on. That being said, I'd like to occasionally break these out and use them in an actual outdoor environment. As is, the excavators actually held up relatively well, though I could definitely see after a couple runs of that burning out one of the track motors. So keep an eye out as I'll be releasing some files to make the excavator more sandproof. And while fine sand is alright, these bigger pebbles that I was actually filming these shots in proved to be a lot more troublesome as they were actually getting stuck in the tracks themselves and binding everything up, which I then have to pick the model up and bang the rocks out. So if you liked any of the builds you saw in this video, whether it be the excavator, skid steer, or these dump trucks, consider becoming a Professor Boots Workshop member on my website, professorboots.com, which will give you access to step-by-step guides on sourcing everything you need to make these projects. Though the physical 3D files I make totally free so that if you want to demo everything first before committing to the workshop, I completely understand that. And all of those can be found on printables. The workshop is a great way to support the channel and is the primary way I'm able to keep making these small 3D printable RC projects that also serve as an introduction to Arduino and common robotics parts. Which actually leads me to answering a good question I get a lot, which is why I don't use common RC electronics. It's not that I have anything against RC parts, it's just the fact that I love the idea that even though we may just be building a mini RC dump truck, we're actually getting hands-on experience with powerful micro development boards like the ESP32 development board, as well as parts like H-bridges, buck converters, etc. that act as the foundation of any good robotics project. So looking ahead at the next project, the community has voted and the next project will be a crane. Though there's a lot of different cranes out there, so in an attempt to narrow it down just a little bit more, go ahead and drop a comment down below on your favorite model of crane, and whatever has the most comments will be what I base the crane off of. So if you don't want to miss that video, make sure to hit the subscribe button as it helps the channel a lot, and of course, thank you so much for watching. Now go 3D print some RC construction equipment simply because you can.